problem now, right? We would be moving towards the interfaces now. So what is diamond problem? So see here, there is a situation like I have an education class, all right, and in education class I have one method available, that is learn language, right? Now two different classes are extending this class. I mean, education can be provided in the online learning mode or through the book also, and say you are having this education from the college. So anybody can extend this as far as the online learning is possible, and the same thing you can have from the book also. So same method can be overridden there also, like the learn language, and for book also learn language is possible. So this part must be clear to you guys, right? So far whatever I'm saying, this a simple inheritance case, like one parent class and multiple child class, C1 and C2. Now comes to the tutor part. Let's say for an example you are going to the college, you have gathered some information on the online mode through some channels and so, and you have also acquired the knowledge from book, but you are not satisfied. You hired a tutor for you and for the learning purpose, but that tutor can again get the knowledge from the either from the learning online mode itself and from the book also, right? The same thing he can do. So this is a valid case of inheritance, like both are different things with respect to the learned language, but that will not work into the Java. So I can quickly showcase that thing to you through the program.
A child cannot have two parents, that's what you are saying, right?
Right. That thing is all must be clear to you guys, correct? That is what I was keep saying earlier also. So I can showcase quickly in 2 minutes related by creating a program. And then we will move forward with respect to the similar concepts. Okay. Let me create here only. Say for an example, education, I have public void learn language. Okay, and from college. Let me copy this part, and same thing is possible for online learning, this one, if I create book class, this one. Right. So far so good. If I want to create something, some object here, like I have main method, will test only for one thing. Like I create an object using the reference of parent or that things you have already seen. So let's not waste time to creating an object and explain that. But that is possible. You can try yourself later on. Now coming to the tutor part. Okay, and now see, if I copy and paste this and two things I forgot of extension. Extends education. This one also extends from the education. So that is the case of first diagram which I shown of the diamond problem, the first three classes, right? And the second case, say for an example, extends, if I say online learning, that is fine. But as soon as I say book also, it started complaining. Java started complaining, I do not support multiple inheritance, right? So now by looking into this case, it seems like it is valid case, like the tutor can have knowledge from the online learning also and the book also. So now how to resolve this part? I still want to create a capability of inheriting from both cases. So on those instances, the interface comes into the rescue. Using the interface, you can easily achieve the multiple inheritance part. Alright, so far we are seeing that the multiple inheritance is not possible for us because we are trying to extending our child class from two parents, and that is not supported as of now in Java. Okay, so let's move on towards the multiple inheritance. So as of now we don't know what is interface, but one thing is clear, what I said, that the interface is used to multiple inheritance. So far so good, right? I did not explain anything. I just throw a statement like the interface is used to achieve multiple inheritance in Java. Multiple inheritance is clear to us, like two parents, single child, or same child, not single child, one child is having two parents. So now let's move on to the next slide now. Now what is the inheritance? How to understand the inheritance? Let us see that part now. So inheritance, the inheritance by definition, let me read out few definitions. Yeah, go on. Any question?
It is interface. You are saying it as inheritance, I guess.
Oh, so sorry. I
no problem.
Thanks to correct me. Okay. So what is interface? An interface is a contract of what the classes can do, right? One thing which we understood, that I'm saying that interface is a contract, some contract or a protocol or common understanding. So what is that? We will see in a while, in some few moments. Or few definition, I'm just writing down the definition, like the interface define a set of common behavior. What are the common behavior of different person? Or interface is a pure specification without any implementation. So note down it that it's a pure specification without any implementation. Now let's dig further into the interface and try to understand the interface scenarios, right? Starting from the inheritance. When I started teaching the inheritance, then I said that to use the inheritance judicially, right? Inheritance cases are those cases which fulfill the is a relationship. Correct, is a relationship. Now, moving on, say for an example, if I take the example, a real world example, parent and child. Child must inherit a lot of things from its parent, correct? There might be a lot of property of the parent which we by default inherited. So I can say that the absolutely child extends from parent, right? I just write extend from parent. But there might be a scenario, say for an example, I have extended lot of things from the parent and I replace myself in Java, but I have inherited or I want lot of property of other things also, like I am an employee also, correct, at the same time. So I have the capability of employee and I must inherit those things. So that won't be possible, because in Java we can say that the one thing can only extend a single class only. So whatever the perfect class, or in other words, if something is cloned of something, then only we need to extend that particular class. Because what Java says, if you have extended something from the other class, you would not have the capability of the extension of any other class. Then you will have to do some other ways for the extension. The other things which I have informed you, like the has a relationship. Earlier, if you wanted to have the capability of other things, then you were using those things as a has a relationship, like the composite relationship itself. In the parent class, if that parent class needs some employee, then maybe, or the child class needs some other class object than what we were doing, like we were creating an object, like I have a class A somewhere else and I need the capability of class A also in my child class. I cannot extend that, but I can always do A equal to new A inside that class. So that would also facilitate the, not through the inheritance, but whatever the rule is applicable, like public methods, we can directly access and use that thing out of that. Now coming back to this example, now say you have thrown some keyword, abstract class you have written like runner, and you have defined run method there. Now runner seems to be like interface itself, a meaning of interface itself, whatever, or the abstract thing itself, whatever we can think of a kind of interface, and that is not meant for the absolute inheritance. So try to understand through this example. Now say for an example, I have runner, right, and in that runner I have run method. Now coming to the various examples, an employee can also run, right, and it's in its own way. Employee would be running in its own way if he wants to run. Same type, an electronics equipment also runs, like I can run the fan, I can run the TV, my microwave or anything. So electronics equipment can also be run, a car can also be run, an institute can also be run, like I'm running some institute, we generally say, right? So, and the system can also run, any system like government system or our own system. So what is runner and run now? These are the abstract things which we have defined here, and any things, they can run it by their own way or by their own definition. But one thing for sure, that employee would not extend the run class, right? Runner class, because employee has not meant for the running only, right? Employee can extend the person class, every employee would be person, right? But you cannot say that every employee would be runner, or the runner is only an employee, right? Whosoever is run, it would be an employee only. So the same thing goes for here also, and the same thing for the athlete also. The athlete can also run. So what is run? So what we do on those cases, we define some interface, like I have this window and this window says run, and we have given it name like runner. Whosoever is run, we have named a good name to this like runner, the interface name like runner. Now what we have done, I know that it does not make sense for me to give any default meaning here, because runner with respect to the different context entirely changed. For employee, it's physical running equipment, it's a mechanical running, like the, we run that particular equipment. Car is again run, but it's own way, and institute is again. So what I mean to say here, that implementation part for every entity, a different classes which implement this, is altogether different, or 100% different. So that's why what we do in on those cases, we define one interface, and that interface is absolutely empty. We do not define any definition there, and make that class abstract. Abstract meaning you are only giving the blueprints or definition, not a concrete implementation there. Like this run method is abstract. I'm not going to define it by default, and let the child classes, according to their use, they can define it. So now what gonna happen, like the employee class can not only extend the other class, say for an example, employee class, say that is perfect example, that employee class is already extending person class. We can say employee is a person, and if it wants the running capabilities also, then implements a runner. So in this way, what gonna happen? This is our employee. This is our person class. This one is employee, and it is extending the person's behavior. Now we have a runner interface also. And that is also being in class diagram, we represent it in the dot dot way. If you see in any UML, the dot dot way representation and concrete arrow representation, that for the class, and that is for the interface. So that is for sure, the person class can have lot of methods available which are concretely defined over there, right? Let's say it has method M1. And there is some definition of the M1. So say for an example, a person class or the parent class of any child have the method implemented for its credit card, debit card. A father can have a credit card and debit card. So the inherently the child can also use the same debit card or credit card related operation. It's no need to redefine it over there. That has already been implemented there. But runner may have run method, and that is not being defined there. That is only the definition is left over there. No concrete implementation with respect to the interface. And it is leave to the employee class. Whatever way the employee wants to use that particular runner method, he can choose that part, and he is independent to use that particular run method in any manner. If you want to use it, then you can use it runner class also, run. So are you with me so far, what I mean to say, and what is interface, and what is the use of the interface, or any doubt so far?
Can we implement from multiple interfaces?
Yes, definitely. I was coming to that part only.
Okay.
Say the beauty of this part was, like right now an employee is extending the person, so its extension has been ended now. It would not extend anything from the person, and it is implementing from the runner, but there might be a chance that the employee can be say for an example, the employee can be tutor also. So maybe we have the another interface tutor here. And it might have a method like teach, right? Then again, I did not concretely define this here, and I leave it to the how the child class itself, how the child class would like to teach from the tutor, right? So it's responsibility of child class. How it wants to do it, but we can implement it. We are giving the capability of this class, like now it can implement the tutor also.
So multiple, more than two also possible.
Yes. So one thing keep in mind that interface allows multiple inheritance. I mean, not only the multiple inheritance, you can extend the multiple interfaces. So let's see some examples now. What are the thumb rule? How we define in the? There are a lot of rules revolve around the interface in Java. How to define the method, what about the variable, what is the keyword of the interface, and that's all. Let's get our hand dirty on the interface, and then I'll be coming on the more real world scenario, for few more real world scenario on that. So far so good, right? The things which I explain right now make sense to you. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's move on. You are also good, Madhu, correct?
Yes, Kanaya.
Okay. So let's see some rules around the interface. Okay, interface. Let's understand the basic concept of interface. First thing, keep in mind, whenever you define any interface, it has the keyword interface itself. Like in case of class, we would like class, then followed by the class name, right? So for the interface is like the interface keyword is used and followed by the interface name, and same naming convention is applicable for the interface also, like the class name. That is not compulsion, you won't have the any compile time error, but the rules like the class should start with the camel case and the following words should also be started with the camel case. So same rule applicable for interface also. So that thing is clear to you. Right, now let's move on. One thing which I said, like the we do not define anything into the interface. So interface, all methods in interface are by default. All methods in the interface are by default public static abstract. So now one more keyword has been introduced, abstract, like, right, method. So whenever you see the abstract keyword in front of anything, then assume that particular thing is not defined completely. So this method one is not just declare here, but does not have any definition, not defined in a concrete way. If I do the same thing into any class, that class would get complaining to me if I write down the things related to the abstract class. The abstract class I'll introduce later. The any class without any definition you haven't seen as of now, right? Whatever you have seen as of now, some definition, even if I left the curly braces empty, but there were some definition. When we start the curly bracket and end the curly bracket like this, I did not like this. And let's say, let me change the method name, right? It says where is definition, add body, right? The first fix it says. So that part is clear to us syntactically. What we have to make sure that the keyword should be the interface, and one more keyword is introduced, that is abstract, which is applied with the method, and that must be the definition should not be there for that particular method, otherwise it started keep complaining to me, like this case, see here, cannot define a method if I uncomment this in the interface. Now that it would have been class, it did not complain me anything, but it has started complaining me in the interface that don't define here anything. I'm not meant to define anything here as of now.
So basically abstract keyword must be used over here for every method.
Yes, absolutely right. The abstract and public also.
Okay. And
so I'm yeah, go on.
I did not understand the class thing. So in the class we can also have an empty method, right?
Empty method is okay, but only declaration should not be there. Like the same thing, if I have done the curly bracket start and then the body is there, but we do not write anything into the body.
If we remove curly brackets, then that means only the method definition is there, right?
Definition, I would not say declaration. Okay. The more appropriate word, declare, we declared this thing. Definition means we have attached the body also.
Okay. So method declaration is here, but we can make it possible by adding abstract in the class also, right?
Abstract in the class also, but that is possible with the abstract class only.
So we have to write abstract here and we have to write abstract on the top also.
Yes. So if that has many more things. Okay, Madhu has typed something. Let me see that also. If a method does not have any implementation, then it has to be abstract, and which means there is an abstract method, hence we will have to make the class an abstract class. Yes, that is true, Madhu. I'll be coming to the abstract class later on. There are a lot of other things attached with the abstract classes, so we will cover later on for the abstract class. So wait till I introduce the abstract class, but whatever you have written makes sense. That is right, correct.
Okay.
Yes. All right, did you get whatever we have discussed so far, right? No problem as of now. Yeah.
One more question. When you created the abstract method, you have the return type as void. So should all abstract methods have a return type of void?
No, does not related to, you can return anything out based on your wish. There is no compulsion on the return type. Two things we have compulsion. I'm coming to that. First thing, your method must be public only, not anything else. Now, why so? We can discuss that. First thing is clear that the abstract keyword is written here, right? The abstract and then void method one. So that thing is like, that thing is like the abstract keyword is defined with the method itself. But keep in mind two things that I'm going to introduce now. first thing is your method access specifier must be public only. Now one question arrives straight away, rather than two questions should arrive. First thing, why public only? Second thing, if you noticed, I did not write public, but that was still working without any problem. So we know so far that when we do not write anything in front of any variable or method, that by default turned into the default type, right? So to answer the default type question, your compiler is so much smart and written in a way, even if you do not write the public in front of this or leave the don't define any access modifier, it inherently inject public keyword for you. So in during the compilation time, it would be injecting public keyword for you. It has give the developer the relief that if you do not define anything, that is okay, I'll do that for you. But other than public, nothing is possible. Like private, it not possible, right? And now we would like to discuss few things. The private we understand, but what is the problem with the why public only? What is the problem with the protected? Right. So let's discuss the protected one now. Why we can't apply the protected? As I said, one thing keep in mind. In the runner class, I was saying this is only a contract, right? I didn't write anything. That means this is just an interface only. Somebody has thrown some name to me, right? Some meaningful name to this. The runner has the run method, nothing else. No concrete definition. So what is the usefulness of make it protected? If I make this particular thing is protected, then what is the message would be conveyed? Only the child class can access that particular stuff, no other things. But from the definition, we have seen even the employee can extend, implement the runner class, electronics equipment can implement it, athlete can implement it, system can implement it, and anybody else can implement it. And while we have not given any single definition there, so why bothered? So that is why we always keep the Java librarian keep these things into the mind, and they make the compulsion for the method that if you are going to define any method and that is abstract only, there is no definition lying over there, so keep that method public. So any class in the future which coming up, we don't know, we are have only discussed the six classes here, different classes, there might be n number of classes that needs this capability. So if those classes can implement that, that is why the protected keyword also not defined there as of now, as of today into the Java. So that's why only the public keyword is supported along with the interface name. All right.
Even so basically protected means child classes can inherit usually, right?
Yes.
If we want this method, this abstract method, obviously we'll be writing implements child class in this interface. That's how we write it.
Yes.
So in that case.
Yes. So we are go on. Sorry.
So in that case, all child classes can anyways use this. So protected is not.
I'm sorry. Yes. So see here, if you try to understand, did I write anything other than the name itself, method one, nothing else, right? Mm-hmm. So it's just treated like a contract only. So whosoever has fulfilled this contract, you are welcome. You can implement this interface and define that particular method in your own style. So why we should introduce protected also here, right? I should give the license to everyone in this universe. You want this behavior from me? Because as I said, any class might have n number of behaviors from the other classes with respect to the better design that somebody has already defined some interface, and that makes sense to me. Like employee extend from the person, but that perfectly makes sense for the employee that most of the capabilities he extend from the person, but the some capabilities like as I was saying that he is runner also, he run also, so he can implement from the runner class, so nobody should stop him. He can be at the same time tutor also, he can teach to anybody, so he can implement. So how he gonna teach, that would be leave to the that employee class itself, that what is the way he teach, what subject he would be teaching. The same case with the runner, what kind of runner that employee is. He is he a marathon runner, or he just practice that particular stuff for his own health, the regular running itself or jogging itself. So such kind of things over there. So what interface says, I'm only the contract, and whosoever fulfill that particular contract, they can use that interface. And keep yourself in mind that whether that contract is applicable for you, or you are just using in wayward way. So if things make sense to you, then you can implement those things. Okay, Madhu has typed something. The way I understand it is, interfaces don't have any code logic. So if you use a third party API, then you need to know what methods are available, which means making those public makes sense. All other access modifiers are redundant. Yes, correct, Madhu. Your understanding is absolutely right. Even when maybe if you have seen web services and all, nowadays the REST services into the picture. So every web service is written in a way they have the interface and their implementation, and the interface are public. So what we say, they share your API endpoints. So endpoints are nothing but a method, an abstract method, like what your web service interface is provide, what this API is provide. Like I write a calculator web service, somebody can come there and calculate something, then I am exposing four methods, add, like subtract, multiply or division, so something like that. So a kind of that thing only. Your understanding is correct, Madhu. Okay, any doubt? Right, so do not treat it like a class way. Just keep in mind the interface wherever applicable, that would be public and abstract. Something has changed in the Java age. I'm not saying that stuff today. Once I'll be complete with the basic stuff, then I will introduce what has enhancement has made into the Java age. Otherwise you would get confused related to the interface. So as of now, keep in mind that the interface does not have any concrete definition, while Java 8 onwards we have the concrete definition also. So I'll come to that part later on. So once I'll be preparing few example set for you and then explain that part. But as of now, keep in mind that the only the declaration with respect to the method exists for the interface. Clear, right? No problem so far with respect to the understanding of the interface for whatever we have discussed.
It must be public, it must be abstract.
Can I have one question actually? So the methods can...
Go on.
Yeah.
Go on, Madhu.
Go ahead, Anil.
No, what I said is it must be public, it must be abstract with no core logic or with no definition, just declaration, that's all.
Yes, absolutely right. Yeah, Madhu, go ahead with your question.
And my question is, it can, so from a signature perspective, it can have any number of parameters passed to it, right?
any number of parameter, no restriction around the parameter, right? Let me add
okay.
that also.
And of course, same number of parameters should be used in the class, right? From interface.
Yes, yes.
The signature must be same then.
Yes, that's right. I mean, whosoever would implementing that, I mean, as soon as I write the interface and say the implementation, if I write the other, accidentally if I write the other name, it would not leave you until unless you do not correct it. While the inheritance, you would not know if you are meant for the overriding, but for this case, it would not leave you. So let me explain that part to you. But before that, just give me 1 minute break and I'll resume the class, all right? Just 1 minute break, guys.
Madhu, are you there? నాది ల్యాప్టాప్ ది టచ్ మౌస్ ఇట్లా అంటాం కదా క్లిక్ చేస్తాం కదా ల్యాప్టాప్ కీప్యాడ్ మీద ఆ మౌస్ డిసప్పియర్ అయిపోయింది మధు ఐఎమ్ అనేబుల్ టు యూజ్ యాక్చువల్లీ అంతే
ఓకే
ఇంకేం తెలుసా ఏమన్నా I can't navigate, I can't click, I can't do anything.
So basically disable in under.
Obviously
function F5 go to you.
Login out on the sorry, reboot chassis on the pardon see. Let me log in.
Login gather. Function F5 go to the list of the
neck. Aha. Shutdown is it? అదే ఫోర్స్ షట్డౌన్ లెట్ మీ బ్రింగ్ ఎ ఫిజికల్ మౌస్ ఐ విల్ బ్యాక్ ఇన్ 30 మినిట్స్
ఓకే ఐ కమ్ బ్యాక్ గైస్ యూ వాంట్ టు కంటిన్యూ డిస్కస్ సంథింగ్ యూ కెన్ గో అహెడ్
నౌ నీల్ వాస్ హావింగ్ ఇష్యూస్ విత్ దిస్ ల్యాప్టాప్ సో హి వాస్ జస్ట్ గోయింగ్ టు గెట్ us ఫిజికల్ మౌస్
ఓకే
Once Anil gets back, I have a couple of questions on the interface. I just asked those when Anil is back.
Yeah, I'm back. I'm back. You can ask questions.
Okay, the first question I had, Kanaya, was, so interfaces, they don't have constructors, right?
Constructor, they don't have. You are already, I mean, you are saying in advance, I supposed to say that, yes. Constructor because it doesn't make
okay,
sense
so you're
to
create
an instance. Yeah.
Okay, okay. So I will not ask the remaining questions because I'm just correlating, comparing this with a class and based on whatever I see in the class, I'm just trying to ask the questions and interface.
Okay.
So that's fine. Since you're anyhow going to cover it, I'll not ask the other questions.
Okay. And once I covered that and if you any question left, then certainly you can ask that, right? Okay, let me know Anil once you are back so I can go ahead with my explanation.
I'm back, Kanaya.
Okay, so let's continue then. All right. With respect to the interface, what I was saying, I forgot actually what I was explaining you
no,
last time.
We just ended where we thought like, you know, public must be there, abstract must be there, and method will have only declaration but no definition. And then Madhu asked about the number of parameters.
Yeah, number of parameters he asked. And one thing I wanted to show, okay, so give me one moment. If I recall that, then I'll prepare the example set. Then otherwise, I'll go ahead with the other explanation. The class methods. Okay, that's not coming up in my mind. Once that comes, then I'll explain that. So let's move on with respect to the other stuff. One more thing, keep in mind, you can even remove the public abstract also here. Okay. So what does it mean that just like in method 2, see here, if I remove public also, JVM will by default append this public abstract keyword for you by default, even if you don't define that. So meaning to say that, like, you have public abstract void m1, this is valid. You have public only, that is valid. And you even remove the public also, that is also valid. So what your IDE will do for you, that would be converted into this method itself, this one itself. Okay, so it get converted into this, and this one also get converted into this. So just have given the facility to us that even if we do not write any access modifier, that would be treated like public only. Even if we don't write abstract with the interface, then it would append the abstract keyword along with that also. So one more definition we have now with respect to the interface, that interface have all abstract methods only, right? Or in other words, all methods are interface are by default abstract, correct? Is this clear to you? Right, nothing yes. Fancy here, just I was saying that we can remove this part. Now coming to the interface part, that see one thing, when is the need, I say that there is no constructor available in interface. So meaning that we cannot instantiate the interface. Just like class, we can instantiate the class, but we can't instantiate the interface. Because it does not make sense to have the constructor. We cannot have the constructor, but because first thing, constructor is a concrete definition, right? You have to define that. While we are already saying the abstract things over there, all methods are abstract. So forget about the constructor. So when we cannot create the object of the, we don't have the constructor. So in other words, we can't create an instance of the interface, and that does not make sense also, because nothing is concretely defined. Then what is the need to define the constructor in that class itself? Right? Are you guys with me? Any confusion? Okay, now you can ask your question, Madhu. What is your question around the constructor for interface?
No, the first question I had was, so interfaces don't have constructors.
Yes.
And you already answered that. The second question I had was, so by default, any variables that we create in an interface are static and final, correct?
Yes. Again, you are going ahead before my explanation. Yes.
So that's the reason why I didn't want to ask the other questions actually. So.
Okay.
So I'm coming to be static and final, which means you won't have getters and setters in it.
Yes, definitely. See, if I have getters and setters, that means I'm defining something. Definition would be there of the method. An interface does not allow that. So how could I take the getter and setter in my class, right? As simple as that.
Body.
Yeah.
Setters have body.
Right? Yes, just only body. And after that, later on, I'll be introducing about the abstract class. Like many times, the things, hybrid things, cases is there that sometime, okay, I want to leave something as an abstract, but still I define something, then what I do, then abstract class is an answer for that. So we'll be coming on that part also later, but later on, once the interface is complete, then we'll be explaining the abstract class. And then we will be correlating these two things, what are the differences, and we will have more robust concepts around the interfaces and abstract classes. So now the
okay,
things
I
are... Go on, Madhu.
One last question actually.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can go back to the previous slide that you were showing.
Slide or this thing?
So here, your notes. So here you mentioned in line 21 through 25 that even though you don't mention public and abstract, JVM will by default consider it as abstract and public, right?
Yes, absolutely correct.
So for classes, if you don't mention the public, if you for line number 25, mm-hmm. it takes mm-hmm. it as a default method.
Default access modifier.
Yes, definitely.
Access modifier is default.
Yes, the line number 25.
So it actually looks for the keyword which is interface and then ignores the, then it actually considers it to be public and abstract, right?
Yes, right. Because then only okay. that is accessible to you. Many a time interfaces are coming up from the jar itself. So if they have made it like protected, private, then what is the need of interface? Make some other classes. You don't want to give one thing you are saying to your client that I have created some interface and anybody in this universe can use it. And secondly, if you are putting in some restriction, then better make something else. Make your own class, make your abstract class or whatever restriction you want to give. So interface is just kind of any public property, but you did not declare and only declare there, you did not define anything there. So whosoever wants to use that, this is the abstract thing, this is a concept only because we haven't done anything so far, did not write anything. So just for the better correlation that, okay, runner can run and now runner could be anything in this universe. Whosoever wants, even the unrelated thing want to be a runner, like static thing. If I say my table and chair also runner, it does not complain. It's up to me. That would be my bad design that I have implemented runner for my table and chair class also, while that is nowhere running here and there, right? So it's up to us. It's up to the developer whether they use it or misuse that. That would be consequence. There would be a bad design or later than sooner they would remove the particular unrelated stuff from their code. Okay, moving on to the other part. Let's discuss these things quickly if I missed something or not. So variables, variable I have to discuss. Method declaration only public and abstract, right? We have seen why public only. An interface can extend more than one parent interfaces. So interface can absolutely extend more than one interfaces. I guess that I was wanted to say you say for an example that thing I wanted to explain through the concrete implementation.
So in, so we have
let's say the
we have
yes
we have inheritance between interfaces also.
Inheritance is here. I'm explaining about the interfaces, like the multiple interfaces can be extended with any class. So let's come back to this class itself, the tutor class itself, and say I would write a real quick things, few things only. It has method m1, right? Void m1. Consider by default that it is public abstract. I'm not writing that part. Oh, sorry. One thing, what I was doing, see in the ID itself, whatever we were creating using this, it was creating so far class only. If you want to directly create an interface, then also there is a possibility. Go into the ID. Now this time around, click on this drop down part. It has interface also, enum also, annotation also. So I want to create interface, hit on the interface and write I2 here. Okay, and say it has void m2. So my tutor now can implement I1 as well. See, as soon as I write this, I remember what I was telling you. Like in case of inheritance, say for an example, class parent, right? And it has method M1, class child. It would automatically have this M1 method, right? And if I try to override, and I can override here, redefine the M1 itself in this class, like child way. But what if I forgot to over, I actually wanted to override that class and I did not apply the override annotation also, and I write like M11, then I won't have any idea that this is the overridden case for me. Only at the runtime when my behavior would be abnormal, not the way I want, then only I come to know that I have made some mistake, because this method is M1. So M1 is coming up with the child class inherently, like M1 is available here, but we have not override that. We forgot to the override that due to the incorrect name of the method name, and we skip the @ override annotation part also here. But there is a beauty with the interface. You cannot run away with the method. So I wanted to say that thing to you earlier, like I know I have the M1 method available there, right? The I1 has the M1 method available there. So what if I, one thing, your IDE gives you the shortcut to implement every unimplemented method. So just hover over this and it will give you the add unimplemented method. So I just have done that part, even if, so it has been implemented, right? Even if I remove the @ override annotation. But say for an example, I accidentally make it M11. See here again, it come back to here and says you did not implement me my method, then what is the need of interface? So when you take an interface, there is no if and else there. If there are 20 methods available, you have to override every method in your class. And if even if you make the spelling mistake, it would keep complaining to you at the compile time itself that implement that, otherwise you cannot run me. So that's why you have to implement. Even if you forgot to implement that, you have to do that, right? So one thing is that. Now, one more thing, let's say I have multiple methods. M2 also here. So choices are not there that it's up to you. You can override only M1 and leave the M2. You come to the tutor part again, it would again start complaining that you haven't implemented M2. Either remove me or you have to implement that part. So one restriction with the interface that you have to implement it's every method. Did you get this, what I mean to say?
Yeah, but if we have an interface with like more than 5, mm-hmm. more than 10, I don't know. I'm just saying in real time, like, you know. So do you guys implement mm-hmm. all the methods of interface in the class?
Yeah, that was the problem earlier with the interface. I won't say with respect to the Java 8 onwards. I'll explain that part later on. That was the problem. What people supposed to do, like I'm using any interface from the jar itself, right? Somebody, say for an example, Madhu has written something and he has provided through the interface itself. Let's say Madhu is writing the calculator class and Anil has written the client calculator, right? You are using the calculator class. So what Madhu has done, Madhu has given the add operation there and rather say it interface I and subtract operation there, right? I'm not passing any parameter, so consider that is available. So what Anil has done, Anil has implemented the calculator from the jar, and this thing is coming up from the jar to you, Anil. You do not have this, you have included the library, whatever the Madhu has provided you. Like the, say for an example, I'm using the object class that coming up from the library itself. I have no license to check anything change into this class. It's coming up through the jar only to me. So I cannot see, like I can type in anything into this and I can recompile this. So same thing, Madhu has introduced you the add and subtract method. You are implementing this and happily you are using the add and subtract method in your class. Right. Now some other day later on, what Madhu has done, he has included multiplication also. And you have used the latest version of that jar in your class now. Now it started complaining to you. Now you don't know what Madhu has changed, but it started complaining and your code stopped working. Hey, implement the multiplication now. But what you thought earlier that I would be having the add and subtraction logic only for me, I don't need any other logic, but it compels you to use the multiplication logic also. If somebody changed it, then you have to pay the consequences that you would be using multiplication also. Otherwise, your code would stop working and it would started giving you the compilation error. So that is the problem with the interfaces. Even whatever the web services are designed, which we said contract first web services. So contract first means contract defined first, your interfaces defined first. So make it as flexible as much you can, like define your contract in a better way, define your interface endpoints, or in other words, the declaration method in a better way, so that later on the minimal changes would be required into the client classes. Otherwise, say imagine a situation calculator has been implemented by 100 classes, right? Not only the one class, while the 2, 3, 4 and so on, it's going to the 100 classes. All 100 classes would get impacted. All 100 classes need to do that part. need to inherit that part now, and all classes would stop working now, and they don't even know that what's going on. Somebody from the library has made some changes, and now I'll have to, I mean, what we say, unintentionally I'll have to implement. And while there is no need for Anil to use the multiplication, but what Anil has to do compulsory, he would be implementing the multiplication, and he has to leave the body part empty, so that even if somebody calls the multiplication, nothing happens over there. So that were the restrictions with the interface. I'll explain through the Java 8 also that how we can minimize those stuff using the Java 8. So we'll be discussing that part later. So far so good, right? Or any confusion questions here with respect to the understanding?
Just one question. I know that you are going to discuss about how to tackle this problem from the Java 8 onwards, and we are going to discuss that. I understand that. But you know what? The question is, it's a quick question. So from Java 8 onwards, is it like we don't have to override all the methods of interface?
It's not like that. In Java 8 onwards, you have the concrete body also with the method.
Okay.
But some special keywords with that. So define, you want something in your interface that your client may not require those. You can define those concrete body. Right now I'm saying the abstract method only, but Java 8 has introduced like append the default keyword in front of any class. Then that would be, and over there you have to define the body of that particular method, and that implementation would be no need for the client classes. Like if Madhu has defined the multiplication like default, I'll showcase that later on.
Yeah, no problem.
Then you don't have your client code would not break. These 100 classes would not suffer. Whosoever want to do that, implement that, inform that, like the user number 3 and 4 only wants that. So inform that I have default method available in my library, use that, and I don't want to break others code. So that's why I'm providing that particular method through the default one.
Yeah, we can discuss that later. That's fine. Thanks. Yeah.
All right. So let's move on. Any question as of now related to this? Okay, then let's move on. Okay, now try to understand few more things. Let me draw a picture and ask you question, and then we will discuss other things. One second. I have interface I1. Okay. I have interface I2. These are the common questions, I mean tricky questions, frequently asked into the interview. I have a class which implements both interfaces. I1 and I2. It has M1 and this one has M2, and my class C is implementing, I'm only writing IMPL, I1 and I2 both. I1 comma I2. So now tell me what needs to be implemented by this class.
Both M1, M2.
M1 and M2. That's fine. Say for an example, if I have M1 also here, nobody stop you by writing that, right? Say for an example, Madhu has write this class. and you are providing me through your API, your jar, Madhu's jar I'm using, and Anil has written this interface, right? And Anil has also introduced M1 method. Then what will happen with the class then? I have to take both people's jar. And now I have duplicate methods available. One with the Madhu also, and second one with the Anil also.
Mm-hmm. I mean, as for the role, all those need to be implemented, but they have same method. Do they have different bodies?
Yes.
I don't know. Still doesn't matter. I don't know. Not sure.
What is your
so
call?
The signature is the Madhu? Same for both, right?
Come again?
So you're saying that the signature in both the interfaces are the same?
Yes, same, ditto same. Signature and yes, return type are same. Otherwise, it would must be the both things are public and abstract only. So it's just like M1 is return two types, right? And just like in the class, I cannot have duplicate stuff. So won't it be like the duplicate method scenario here? If I write in my Java code in this way, it says one method is duplicate, remove that part. Think about it.
Yeah, something like imply interface dot method. Can't do that.
Okay, interface dot and
just saying that. Okay, is it something like that?
Okay, let me explain this part. Keep one thing in mind. Like, see, interface dot, this is an instance method, not a static method, right? This is not the static. Now again, I would be saying two things, that Java do not have a static method, but the definition contradicts. When I will be coming to the Java 8, I would say Java now has static method also. But as of now, you keep in mind that the interface does not have static method available, right? I'll be explaining the Java 8 part separately, because there is no necessity that everyone is using Java 8 as of now. So till JDK 1.7, what was happening, I'm discussing that part. So once you have the concrete understanding around that, then I'll be introducing Java 8, so that even if you get confusion, but that confusion is for good, like you would have more understanding that, okay, that's why they have introduced, or whatsoever is the reason, we can discuss that later. But as of now, keep one thing in mind, that static methods are not available in interface. Why static methods are not available? Because static method belongs to class, and this is not a class, this is an interface. So that's why they did not introduce, but later on they realized that because they have given the concrete method also, so they introduced the static method. But as of now, keep in mind that just remember the signature or the rule book what was written for the Java, that static methods were not available till JDK 1.7 in Java. So you cannot write like i1.m1, right? Otherwise it would have been really easy for anyone to understand that, okay, the M1 is coming up from the I1 only. So to answer your question, what would happen in this case? See, one thing is clear.
M1, it doesn't matter, right? Because there's no code logic over there. Irrespective of whether it is in both of those, only one thing would be a return.
Right. The same thing I supposed to come. What matters? I have 10 interfaces, 20 interfaces. I did not define anything there. Yeah. So it won't breach anything in my class. I am responsible for providing that particular body. So I know it's okay the method is coming up from the Anil to me, or no matter it's coming up from the Madhu to me, I would be overriding M1. It's the child class responsibility, and whatsoever way the child class wants to override, it's up to the child class only. So it doesn't matter whether the same thing is coming up from the this class or the Anil class. It has already implemented. When I see that if I implement Madhu, then I see, okay, I have overridden M1, so contract matches, right? If I see Anil, I have overridden M1, but I have not overridden M2 yet. It will give me the error, and I will override the M2 also here in this class. And contract matches, right? So no syntactical error would be there. Now it's my responsibility. What I want to do, what implementation I want to provide, it's up to me. So it's a really interesting thing. Lot of people get confused when this is asked. Even the experienced people also sometimes get confused.
What you are saying?
Keep in mind.
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, go on.
So what you are saying is, in that case, so we have M1 in interface one and M1 same method in other interface also. Then we have to override both the methods though, right? So in one method, one overridden method, we'll have core logic. In another overridden method, we have just empty curly brackets, right?
No, no, not empty curly bracket. That core logic would fulfill the everything. Okay, let's look into the ID itself. Okay. So it would be...
Oh, one time? Okay. Okay, fine. So one is enough then. Okay.
Yes, that's what I was saying. I1 has the method M1, M2. I2 has the method M2 only. So now let's come to this class. And I'm implementing I1 and I2. Right? So M1 and M2 has been fulfilled for the I2. Sorry, for the I1.
Yeah.
And for I2, I have only M1, so that has been fulfilled for that from this tutor class. So concrete definition would be single only, but it is matching for this. Okay, this M1 would be belong from the I1 and I2 both. It's now my responsibility what I want to write, like whatever I want to write, that I'm M1 method or whatsoever, the core logic I want to write here. Get this point? So keep in mind, this is again really good concept around this.
Is it common to see this kind of interfaces having same kind of method and method?
Yes, I mean, who stops me? The whole universe, when we say design to interface, whole world is using interface. The web service, one cannot imagine without the interfaces. And now you cannot write, I mean, you are using two company services. Now you cannot stop other companies that company C1 has written this method, so please don't write in your code. They would be writing independently. It's your wish. You want to use the, imagine about the open source. If you want to use the Apache open source, you cannot stop the Apache that please don't write this interface and don't write these methods into the interface. I have already this in my API. So this is a world of open source. Everybody is contributing, so one cannot stop there. The only thing we can do that we have defined set of rules, and whosoever is would be developing would respect those rules so that others can develop the things easily. Otherwise, who would use the other's API if that is causing more problem than the solution? If some other day, if Apache is as of now open source and causing lot of problem in your code, even though that is open source but causes lot of problem, you would extract out that library and write that logic by your own self. So because who wants to involve in more maintenance code and rectifying other's code every now and then, correct? Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, so one last thing we would be discussing, then we'll close the discussion for the day. Okay, coming to the variable part. Now, variable would be public, static, and final. Why final? because I don't want to override that. See, for interface, there would not be any overriding concept, right? We are not inheriting, for method, it's not a concrete body, only the contract only. So a kind of constant I can give because I have only contract which I can expose to the other. So certainly if I give the variable in a way that I do not define anything, then my every child classes will having the variable, a definition of that variable in their own way. And that particular rewriting would be there. So the interfaces are meant for the contract only. So what again, if you say that what if I want to change it, then use better use the classes or the abstract classes or any other concept, not the interface. But they have made these rules for you. You have to respect those rules. So final is available over there. So whatever you are defining with respect to the constant, you can give the concrete value. Like here, I am giving the 5 only with respect to this variable. And again, it has to be public only because it does not make sense to make it private. Then what is the meaning to introduce this? Even the child class can write their own. They want to use these this constant in their classes. They want to access these constant in their classes. That's why they have given it public. Now, why static? Simple answer, we cannot create constructor, we cannot create object of the interface, so better to make it static so that with the name of interface name, just like the static stuff, the class name and followed by the variable itself. So the interface followed by the variable name itself, you can access that part. That is why they have the public static final variable they have defined in their class. Does it make sense to you? Mm-hmm. So same thing, like I define in one of the interface I1. First thing, it would not compulse me that redefine the X because I have already concretely defined that. So my class should not compulse me. Now coming to the class which is implementing both interfaces I1 and I2, say I want to print the value of X here. So say for an example, I have main method, right? Let me, rather than creating another class, introduce the main method. And inside this main method, I am just printing various ways are possible. Let me show you the other way. Tutor T1 equal to new tutor T1 dot X. I want to print this. That's pretty much simple, right? And file get printed. Now let me ask you one more question here. Let's say this I1 has this variable X available here. And I2 also have the same thing available. So what's gonna happen then? The thing I asked to you is like, now I'm talking about the variable. Keep the things really in the mind. It has variable X defined as 5. You have another I2. It also has the X defined say 10. So Anil has written I1, Madhu has written I2. And one class C implements both I1 and I2. Now what will happen? Think about this.
I don't know.
Would you like to try, Madhu?
No, but first of all, how would you access these variables into a normal class?
This way, you create an object. That's what I have done, that I was using X here, right? I create an object of tutor. I'm implementing I1 and I2. That means that X is providing to me. Using the object, I can access anything, right? So that X variable itself is a public defined over there. If I press F3, this is public. So I can use it by creating an object of its child class. Anyhow, in other words, if I say the tutor is a child class only of that particular I1, right? That's why when we say extend.
Can you do one thing? Can you?
Yes.
In the class declaration on the top, write I2 comma I1.
Okay, I2 comma I1.
Yeah, I don't know. No.
Okay, here.
Number, yeah, I don't know, I'm just trying. Yeah. And then come to,
yeah, I wanted to discuss this. So okay, go on.
Come to t1.x, okay. And then put F3, say F3 on X.
Where?
T1 on 24th line, you have t1.x, right? So
yes.
Do F3 on X.
Okay, F3. Okay, F3 on X would go over there only. Does not matter.
I1, oh, why is it
called I1? Because in I1 I have defined the X. I2 I have not defined yet.
Oh,
X, any variable.
Okay.
I'm just asking, I intentionally did not introduce there. I thought that it. Let me ask you, what is your thought?
Don't know, I thought you have defined
it. How I understand this is, if even if both I1 and I2 actually have the same variable, whatever it implements first, that is the value it will take, because the value is final, right?
Yes.
So the value will be X equal to 5.
So that is incorrect way of understanding this. Let me tell you how. Let me introduce the X variable here also, right? And then we will revisit the same thing. Going to the I2 and just copy and paste, and for the simplicity I change the value here. Now see. Cross coming up here straight away, right? Now it started complaining, who am I don't know, right? It says ambiguity problem. While this problem was not exist with the method, so small things but tricky things you must know. Method, we do not declare anything, so no problem. Child classes are fine, but we remember in interface itself we have declared the variable, we have concrete body of the variable, so it would not leave us now that, hey, what are you doing? I don't know from which X I belong to. Am I of I2 or I1? It does not matter if you write I1 comma I2 or I2 comma I1. Doesn't matter. So how to resolve that? You cannot stop people of writing their own variable. Right? Madhu wish to write the variable. The contract is fine. Java has given us the facility that I can write the public static final variable. I did not breach the issue, and even in my library, say I1 is in some other library, it is working fine. And Anil has also written this, it's working fine for him. So what to do now?
I1.x and I2.x, that's how we should access.
Absolutely. Because still the static concept lying over there, you can explicitly you have to say I1.x so that it would get to know that, okay, I am the X who belongs to the I1. If I want to print of I2 something, I2.x and belong to the I2. So what I gonna do, that's why I intentionally did not write this print statement earlier. I1. Let me comment that out, and dot, see here, X, if I write, the whatever we have written into the I1 part get printed. If I write I2, so both things are available. It's only up to me how I access that. If I going to create an object, that would put me into the trouble. So i2.x, don't worry, it will give you the 10, 5 and 10. Alright, make sense to you guys? Okay, one more thing applicable here. See this line, I have written int y equal to 10 only, but still it's not complaining anything to me. Why? The same rule is applicable here also. Let the JVM do it for us. JVM says, if you don't write anything, I would append public static final for you free of cost. I know I'm always going to be public static final, so whether or not you write it, I don't care. I'll append the public static final in front of that. So always somebody ask you what kind of variables are supported in interface. These are public static final only, but it's up to us whether or not we write that. That would be always the public static final only, but we can leave off writing public static final in my interface, and that would be injected by the JVM for me. Get this point?
Yeah,
so that's all about the definition and what is the contract, how to define the interface, and what are the syntactical things and what is related to the variable and method about the interface. We would see one more real world case scenario where the famously interface being used into the industry. I'll be explaining one more example around that to you guys in next class.
Maybe
so that we can go on.
Maybe that real-time example which you are going to explain us, that will help us to understand, because right now I understand, like, you know, what the syntax, how we should be declared, how we should be accessed or implemented, that I understand, like, you know, but when should I use it, where should I use it, and why should I use it, like, you know. So these things are the ones, like, you know, I don't know, maybe, like, you know, with the example which you are going to explain as next class, that may help us.
Yes, that would be helping you. And now the collection API onwards, the interface would be heavily used. So you must be knowing that the what are the power of interfaces, only the interfaces and their respective implementation. If the things are clear around the polymorphism, then nothing tricky with respect to the interfaces.
Mm-hmm.
So same thing is available. Wherever the polymorphism is applicable, you can replace that part with respect to the reference type from the interface itself. So we'll be seeing a lot of examples around that, and things get clear. So as of now, do focus on what are the guidelines, what are the rules around the interfaces. And at least we have an understanding, like whatever I have explained, that the contracts are different, like employee class, electronics equipment, athlete. So these may be the different. That's why maybe we have interface, we do not define that, and we can implement that stuff into these classes. So in real world also, the one thing you can easily correlate, like you extend any class, then you are not left with any choice. You have to create an interface only for the, if you want to support anything else in your class, right? So that's again the real world case. You are writing something and you have already extended that class. Now no choices left. You have to do that work for the multiple inheritance through the interface only.
No, that time I don't know, I'm just saying. That time, like, you know, I'll keep on adding more methods to the existing parent class. So that's how my